Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Jeff Hurley. I'm the MVPN PSC coordinator for Smith County. I'm coming back at you again this week for our mental health moment. In the last few weeks, we've talked about the five key concepts of RAP. That's hope, personal responsibility, education, self-advocacy, and last but not least, on today, we're going to talk about support. So although working towards your wellness is up to you, receiving support from others and giving support to others will help you feel better and enhance your quality of life. Support's exactly what it say it is. If you're from a military background, it's the same. You know, I'm an operating unit and I have my support structure. I can't be me without them. And it's saying the same thing when it comes to RAP and your wellness, that you alone are an effective individual, but in times of need, you still need your support to get the mission accomplished. Most of us recognize the importance of this, but it can be hard to build a network of peers and supportive people. And to stay connected to that support system isn't always hard nowadays, especially with pandemics and different fears in different places in the state, especially the way we've reacted to the pandemic. So depending on where your family is and who that support structure is, the access to them could have been very difficult this year. And it's easy to find, and even when we don't have a pandemic, I mean, just in our daily lives, as busy as we are as Americans, I mean, it can The list of reasons why we can't get together with our support structure is long, but one of the things that I hear every day is, I don't have time. I don't know what to say. It's been so long since I've talked to them. They're probably too busy. I don't want to intrude on their life. I mean, if you think about it, these are reasons that I haven't necessarily called my parents once a week. I've got the kids. I've got work. There's so much going on. They go to bed early. They just got back from a doctor's appointment. I don't want to interfere with their lives. But that's your support structure. So we always find ways to really excuse ourselves from staying in contact with our support structures. We all need people. I'm often asked, you know, how do I overcome this lift? How do I overcome these excuses to build my support network? Go through this list. And when I say a list, is think of your own life. Who is your support structure? If you're married and your wife's not on this list, we'll have a different segment for that. But for this purpose, that's your direct line of your support. Like, think of your kids. When you were a child, who was your biggest supporter? It's usually your mom or your dad. That same thing echoes us as an adult. So who is my support structure? My coworkers, my wife, my spouse, my mom and dad still, if you're fortunate enough to still have them alive. So think about that list. Write some people down. And on that list, go through it and put a star next to each person who is supportive, very supportive, that knows yourself and is willing to put a boot in your 6 o'clock to get you where you need to be. So when you go through the list, write their name, what makes them supportive, and then answer the following questions. Do I feel respected by this person? Do I trust this person? Does this person bring out my best qualities? Does this person allow me to feel good about myself? Do I leave an interaction with this person feeling positive? So now let's look at some things that we look at. These are, for instance, I'm an introvert. And so one of the things I would use in excuse very often, even today with my support, is I don't like to rely on others. This is my problem. It's for me to fix. It's for me to sort out. And yes, that responsibility, like we talked about a few weeks ago, it is personal responsibility for your wellness. But for some of us that are introverted and we don't like to rely on others, let's look for ways to overcome that obstacle, and find your support system. When do I ask for help? Ask yourself that. When do I ask for help? And what I mean by that is we all have that threshold. Like, I can sit here in my daily job and look around and go, okay, I do need help for this. I do need help with this project. Well, I have trouble reaching out to my superiors, even subordinates, and saying, please come help me. So what can I do? When is that threshold for when I truly feel that I need to ask for help? Do I trust the person I'm asking help from? Does this person, in what situations in the past have I asked for help from this person? What do I think will happen when I ask for this person for help? Do I have negative or positive expectations? For instance, if you're at work and anytime you've asked for help in the past and it's been negative feedback, you probably should not include that person in your support structure. You want to feel positive at the end. You know, if I call my boss now, which you'll get to meet her next week, and I ask her for my help, she is positive. She's confirming. She asks what I can help. She points out those qualities to help me get back to my center of wellness and allow me to be the most proficient and efficient at doing my job. So identify one situation you're dealing with in your life right now that you're overwhelmed with. Look through that list. Who would you reach out for? That is your direct support structure. support is probably, I think, the most overlooked thing with our mental health. At the end of the day, it is our mental health. It is our problem. We are trying to seek our wellness, but you cannot do it alone. You need to communicate with that support structure. You need to know your support structure. Have them identified. Open up to your support structure. What are things that your support notices in you? Because often, I always go back to your spouse. They know you better, and sometimes you know yourself. He could very well, they can know when you need help before you ask for it. So having that good support structure, knowing the intimate details of your life and who you are as a person allows them to be a better support network. So let's work on those as we move forward. This concluded my short series on the five key components of RAP: hope, personal responsibility, education, self-advocacy, and support. If you're interested in diving deeper into this content for yourself or to see the full curriculum, or even if you want to use this for yourself in your daily life or reach out and have this program brought to your employment or into your own personal life, go to www.mentalhealthrecovery.com. And on that, you can see more in-depth material by Dr. Mary Ellen Copeland, who is the original author of the Wellness Recovery Action Plan, which we call RAP. If you enjoyed this content and would like to see more, or if you have any ideas of content you would like to hear about, don't forget to like, click, and subscribe so you can catch all the future content, current content, and old content. And like always, if you have a question, an idea, if you want to come on this show and do your own piece, please give me an email at jhurley@andrewscenter.com or casey@kantvtyler.com. And we look forward to seeing you next week, and we bring you more to it. Thank you.